your troubles, come lay them down. All you sinners and the weak at heart, all you helpless on the boulevard, wherever you are now, whatever even you found, bring all your troubles, lay them down. We're all tied to the same old failing, finding shelter, things we know. We're all dirty, like corrupted small towns. We'll bring our troubles, we'll bring our troubles. High above all those with and without love, all you burdened, broken down, bring all of your troubles, come lay them down, lay them down, just lay them down, lay them down. Yeah.
Good morning. Welcome to our 9:30 worship service for those of you at home and are looking for, some of you may be looking for in an hour our 10:30 worship service. We have suspended that until further notice. If we need it, we can always bring it back, but the attendance at that was not cause to keep it going. But this is our 9:30 celebration this morning, and we're glad to be here. And a couple of things, just check the Facebook, check the online, the web page for things that are coming up. Emily is finishing up with the children upstairs. We're trying to do some children's stuff. Everything is always fluid. We're working on this plane in flight, so things can change immediately with all that's going on with the pandemic. But we're glad to be here, and we're going to continue to try to do this as long as we're able. And so it's a good thing. And our youth are meeting on Tuesday evening at 6 o'clock. And we're trying to keep all of our events to about 30 minutes to one, we can make the connections, and two, we're not around each other for too long if somebody happens to be sick and they're asymptomatic. So we're doing the best we can with that. We got covered all of that. And I'm sure I forgot something, and I'll talk about it later. Let's pray. Good and gracious God, we thank you for this day, for the opportunity to be in worship, to know that you are our God and we are your people. We ask your blessing upon us as we are gathered here, and we ask your blessing upon us as we go forward into the world from this place to share good news with a world that's in desperate need of good news. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Scripture lesson this morning comes from the book of Isaiah. It's chapter 55. It's verses 1 and 2 and verses 10 through 13. Hear now the reading of God's holy word. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and he who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Hearken diligently to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in fatness. And verse 10. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and return not thither, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose, and prosper in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy, and be led forth in peace. And the mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle, and it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign, which shall not be cut off. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. May God's blessing be upon us. And may God protect us from the enemy constantly at work trying to steal God's word from us. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. It was sometime in the late 60s, early 70s, that a theologian said these words. Sometimes they're accidental theologian. I call him an accidental theologian. He said, I can't get no satisfaction. I try and I try and I try, and I can't get no satisfaction. They give me useless information trying to fire my imagination. I can't get no satisfaction. I can't get the reaction I want. You probably don't think of him as being a theologian, but the lyrics that we know and love and like aren't always just because they're loud and musically they sound good. The lyrics of songs that we love and like are ones that speak to a part of our condition about who we are and how we live our lives. And there's a recognition in that song. One of the reasons we like it so much, because we recognize that we aren't nearly as satisfied as we want to be. We want that satisfaction. We want to be satisfied. And we work hard to be satisfied, to make sure we get those things we want. And we spend a lot of our treasure, our money, trying to be satisfied. We spend a lot of time and talent and energy trying to be satisfied. And it starts at a young age, you know, wanting that perfect toy that will just make us feel so good. And if I can't wait to get that, and when I get it, I play with it, and by the end of the day, I'm not as excited about it. And perhaps as we get older, we maybe trying to find our perfect girlfriend or boyfriend, and if they would just say yes to going out with me, and then we find out, well, that's not quite what I was looking for, and we move on, and we're looking for the educational, if I just spend a lot of time and get into the best college, or if I do the work and I get the best job coming out of high school, and I have some skills and I can do something of great importance, like HVAC. You know, everybody doesn't have to go to college. We need some people to do HVAC, and they make a lot more than people going to college, and they keep me cold, and that's nice. And so when we talk about education, it's not always just about going to college. It's about gaining skills that are necessary so that I can be satisfied at least for a moment before I walk out in the heat. It's important. But even with all of that, we find out when we finally get what we're looking for, that we're not quite as satisfied as we thought we would be. And we think, well, I need a better job or a bigger job so I can buy more stuff. And then we go out and buy our first house. And we're like, well, that's really nice. And we're in it for 3 weeks, 3 months, 6 months. We're like, yeah, but these bathrooms need to be upgraded. I need to build a new deck. And when I finally get that, the kitchen. And we find out that it's all nice, and we like it, and we appreciate it, and we use it. But we find that we're not quite satisfied, that something is always lacking. That something is not quite there. We're not quite where we want to be. And again, you know, Mick Jagger and the Stones recognize that with the song, I Can't Get No Satisfaction. Recognize it. But that's part of the condition from the time we were booted out of Eden. The creation has found itself not being quite satisfied with what they have and what they want. And one of the things I like about this passage of Scripture, it was a few years ago, I was studying Isaiah, and I can't remember which translation it was. Again, Isaiah was written originally in Hebrew, and so there's lots of translations, and there's no great translation from the Hebrew into the English, if we're all honest about it. So a lot of times we'll look at different translations, and we'll find something that, one, we think is a good translation, or two, we just like, and this is one I just like. Verse 2 was not, why do you spend your money for that which is found? It was, how do you spend yourself? How do you spend yourself? It was trend. How are we spending ourselves to find ways to be satisfied? What are we spending our money, our treasure on? What are we spending our time and talent on? What are we doing? Because we know that whatever we're spending it on, and Isaiah recognizes this as he speaks to God's people, that part of the human condition, and we recognize that we spend ourselves on things that are very temporal. And temporal things will give us pleasure short term. It will satisfy us in the moment. But we find that even then, that satisfaction, it wanes. It goes away. And one of the things we find is that even when we go out and get those things that we want, if we make a list of the things we want and we start to check off that list, no matter how big or small that list, it could be a life list, a bucket list, it could be a grocery list. If we pay attention, we find ourselves recognizing something important about ourselves. Yesterday evening, I went with the twins. We went to Big Lots. Big Lots right now is a 20% off coupon. Used to do it for like one day, and now they spread it out. You can use it whenever you want, which was nice. So we went to Big Lots to make our Big Lots run, our purchases, and we made a big list, and we had everything on there, and we started to go through the list, and we were buying stuff and checking it off and scratching it out. Full grocery cart full of stuff. We got up to the front, $200 worth of supplies from Big Lots. not bad, really. There's a lot of things that are important, soap and washing powders and all that kind of stuff. You know, good deal. But when it was over with, what I found myself doing was not thinking, what a great deal I have, and look at all this stuff I have and how important it is. I found myself looking at the list, and I go, and I can't believe they didn't have 4 purple potting plants, and they didn't have dill, and they didn't, we make a list, we get so much of it accomplished, but we find ourselves looking around and saying, and recognizing that it's easier to see what we don't have than what we do have. It's easier to see what I don't have in comparison to others instead of what I do have in my own life. And that creates some dissatisfaction. It puts us in a place where we're not quite getting what we want. And Isaiah, speaking on behalf of God to God's people, says, you can be satisfied. You can be satisfied, but not because of your hard work, not because of all that you're doing, but because God has something for you. Isaiah 55 is what I read from. Isaiah 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57. There's kind of 5 chapters in there are where we start to hear about something that's really new for the world. And it comes long before we hear about or know who Jesus is, but there's this thing called, in those parts of Isaiah, if you've done a disciple Bible study, you've heard this term, the suffering servant. It's where you start to hear about this suffering servant, the one who will die on our behalves, who will take on the pain and suffering of the world, who recognizes that our satisfaction can't be made complete. The suffering servant, the one who would pay an outrageous price on our behalf, a sacrifice for us. A true theologian, somebody that worked on this, and probably a couple people, came up with this idea and this phrase called substitutionary atonement. See, that sounds more like a theologian than I can't get no satisfaction. Substitutionary atonement. The one who would die on our behalf, who would substitute the sacrifice for us, where no more sacrifice would have to be made. Now, Isaiah is not speaking specifically about Jesus to that point, because they wouldn't understand that. But we understand in reading Isaiah as those who have become part of not just a Hebrew culture, but a Judeo-Christian culture, that's exactly what God was leading up to. Was the substitutionary atonement, the gift of the one who would pay the outrageous price on our behalf, Jesus Christ, who would come live with us, God's only Son, give himself completely for us, die on the cross for us. A sacrifice on our behalf, Jesus. The one who helps us to understand that our satisfaction, as Isaiah tells us, come, it says, come. Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And he who has no money, come buy and eat. We don't want your money. We don't need that. Come buy wine and milk without money or price. And you think, well, wine and milk, no big deal. I can go over to Food Line and get wine and milk. I can go to the Kangaroo Station right over here and get wine and milk for about $10, I guess. Maybe it's $20. I don't know. I don't buy wine. But $20, you get wine and milk. No big deal. But it's saying come without price, but you say, that's not even that big a deal. It's a huge deal culturally, because wine and milk are luxurious items. They're extravagant. Back when Isaiah was writing this, if you wanted milk, you had to own a couple cows at least, and had the expertise of milking them, and not everybody had cows. If you wanted wine, you couldn't just go to the store and buy a cheap bottle of wine. Couldn't even buy the Morgan David or something like that. You couldn't get any of it. I don't buy it, but I know what it is. You couldn't do that. You had to have a vineyard. Then you had to have patience and time, and you had to have the ability to press it and make it all into wine and all that stuff. It was a luxury item. And Isaiah tells God's people, come buy wine and milk without money and without price. You've been using your money, you've been using your time, you've been using your talent, you've been using all of these things, and it has not fed you or made you satisfied. Why do you labor for which that does not satisfy? You can't get no satisfaction, as was Isaiah saying clearly, unless You hearken diligent to me to eat what is good and satisfy yourselves in the fatness. Satisfy yourselves in what God is willing to give you. He wants you to have these things, but He wants you to come empty-handed. He wants you to come empty-handed. He wants you to get this knowing you can't earn it. Jesus Christ came into the world not because we had figured it out and had put everything in order and finally had gotten it right. He came into the world because God recognized we were never going to get it right. We were never going to figure it out, and there's only one way to do this. You can't earn it. You can't buy it. The only satisfaction is you can receive it. And once we've recognized that, we find that we need to spend ourselves. To spend ourselves in a new way. To spend ourselves doing that which blesses someone else. Our satisfaction comes from God. Our satisfaction comes from the knowledge and understanding that Jesus Christ is giving us all we need. We need to be willing to go forth and share that blessing. To spend ourselves doing that which blesses others, that which brings satisfaction to the greater good, something beyond ourselves. In a few moments, we're going to sing those words about what we're called to do. The words of Isaiah, to go forth into the world. Because God says that His word will not come back empty. But we're to go out into the world, and when we do that, when we go out in joy and we're led forth in peace, the mountains and the hills will break forth into joy and singing, that the trees of the field will clap their hands. That when we find what we've always been looking for, to be satisfied, and we find that we can't buy it, we can't earn it, it's just given to us by saying yes to Jesus. All we can do is go forth into the world with joy and peace to say yes to the world. And again, the world needs for us to do this. The world is desperate for good news. It's desperate for joy and singing. It's desperate to see the mountains and the hills and all creation clapping. How do you spend yourselves? I pray that you, that me, that I, that we will spend ourselves doing something that blesses others. And I pray that we'll do that in Christ's name. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, where are we? Pastoral prayer. I'm going to take care of the prayer, but would you want to come up and make any announcements about children, please?
Good morning, friends. Can you hear me in this? Good morning, good morning. Andy, tell me how to make it work.
Here, see it. Let me see it.
Good morning.
Is the red lights on?
It's on?
It's on now.
Now, can you hear me? Nope, nope. If I talk really loud, can you hear me that way? Perfect. There we go. Teamwork, make the dream work. All right, friends, good morning. And so excited to see so many people here today. We also had a wonderful time this morning. I see several of my River Kid families here doing our in-person Children's Sunday School. And so especially folks online, I just want to remind you that we are back for in-person Sunday School here for our youngest disciples. We also still have it offered online though. So if you're not quite yet ready to come back, please tune in. It looks a little different than it did previously, but we absolutely want you to be a part of our live River Kids worship and Sunday School opportunities. The other thing that we want to announce today, specifically for family ministries, is that we are in the midst of creating what we are calling a visioning team. And this vision team is to let us work together collaboratively as an entire congregation. So even if you are not officially a River Kid anymore, we are all children of God, so we are all River Kids in some capacity. I would love to have your involvement in that. What that means is that you will be a part of either a digital or an in-person meeting time, which will be the same time, but you have the option of either, to come and talk a little bit about what does it look like moving forward in this new season together, and how do we faithfully respond to the Holy Spirit's movement among us, because as evidence here today, it is absolutely taking place. So please let me know if you would like to be a part of that conversation group. I would love to have anyone and everyone. So everyone here is invited, everyone at home online is invited. Please just reach out through either the church phone number or my email, which can be found on our church website. And I look forward to seeing where the Spirit leads us together.
All right. Again, we don't pass the plate during this season. Oops, I got my microphone all wrong. Let's see. Just speaking of microphones, again, a lot of times online and at home, sometimes the sound's not quite perfect and all that stuff. I just want you to know, and again, I'm going to say this, I'll say it again and again, we're getting about a $5,000 product out of a $500 camera because of the work that our sound team has been doing. Jan and, who's back there, Jan and Pat and Andy. I can't see that far. But again, and others, so we thank them for what they're doing. And it's not always perfect, but it's not because we're not trying. Again, $500 camera, $5,000 product. And I don't say that lightly, because they're really pulling some stuff out of this little camera. It's not even as big as the microphone. You can't see it, but this is about the same size as the camera we're working with. There's an offering box on your way out. You can give, going to lrumc.net, PO Box, or PO Box 160, Little River, South Carolina, 29566. I appreciate all the gifts. We have many people in the church family congregation who are here, but we're finding that many of you out there, I don't even know who you are, but I see some of those names come across the online giving. Thank you so much, wherever you are, for supporting the ministry and mission of this church. Some of you who have never been in this building and may never come, we appreciate what you're doing. Thank you so much. We have one prayer quilt up here. We have, I will announce that three people this past week have passed away from our church family. B. Heard, who was at Myrtle Beach Manor, one of the first people I visited when I came to Little River. She had an interesting connection with my father-in-law. She had been one time from Maryland up in the Dundalk area. I remember having that conversation with B. Calvin Borthwick, after a long battle with pancreatic cancer, and Larry Ball. Larry and Billy would usually sit somewhere over here in church, right here. Okay, I knew there was someplace over here. I can't. Larry, after a long struggle, passed away this week. We actually prayed for a quilt for him on Wednesday as part of our preparation for the Sunday services, and sent it off, and Billy got that the day after he died. There's a quilt up here for Ron Schultz. And what we generally do, we're not going to do it exactly like that, is have somebody receive the quilt. Ron, since you're here, you can receive the quilt. So come on up here. And generally we have people lay hands on him. We're not doing that. That wouldn't make any sense when we're trying to do social distancing. You see, even I'm moving away from Ron. And Lou's not here, is he? Okay. But I want to ask you to do, as we pray, is for you to stand with me and to raise your hands as we offer this blessing on Ron as he recovers. Lord, we do come to you in prayer this morning. We come praying for the needs of the world, for the needs of our community and our country. We come praying for a time of division, when we find ourselves separated, black and white, left and right, red and blue, in so many other ways. We come praying for unity, a unity of the Spirit. And we come praying that in the midst of this brokenness and division, that we will find a way to look together as one to you for our guidance. And we pray, Lord, this morning for those whose names have been called, for B and for Larry and for Calvin and their families. And we thank you, Lord, for the life that they have given, that you have given us through them, and for the legacy that they leave. But we pause now to pray for Ron, and for the love he has for you, and for the care and concern he has for others. And we pray for him in this time as he recovers from surgery, and as he makes the next steps in his life and process. And Lord, we just ask for your blessing to be upon him. And we ask that as he receives this quilt, that he will know that he is covered in prayer, and most importantly, covered by your Spirit. And we pray this blessing in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, Amen. And all God's people prayed together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And some of you are here for the first time. Our goal is 30-minute worship services, social distancing, wearing masks, all of those things. As you leave, we ask if you'll leave out of this door so we can just kind of come behind you and clean. If you are unable to, for whatever reason, you can't, the ground's too hard and the sun's too much, and I'm not going to question your reasoning, please stay seated and somebody will usher you out that door. You raised your hands to offer a blessing. I invite you now to raise your hands to receive a blessing. That's what benediction means. It just means a blessing. To receive the benediction. Lord, be with us as we go forth to love and to serve. Be with us, Lord, and help us to spend ourselves on things that are eternal. It's in Christ's name we pray. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, all God's people said, Amen. Amen.